Business Studies, which is a research center that was founded about 2 years ago by a group of enthusiastic academics trying to change the world. Today we have teamed up with Frontline Defenders to host this sort of a lecture by Horia Mosadiq. I'm hoping that I'm pronouncing it well enough. Which was organized by Frontline Defenders, of course, and we are very happy to welcome our speaker today, welcome the organization, and host this lecture tonight. I'm not going to spend any more time talking to you. I'd just like to remind you that in the unlikely event of a fire incident, there are two exits from this room. I think they are quite clearly signposted. So if the alarm goes off, please try to, you know, follow the little green man running down the stairs. With that, I would like to invite Ollie Moore, Director of Frontline Defenders, to the stage to introduce our speakers. Thank you.
I'm Olive Moore, I'm the Interim Director at Frontline Defenders, and it is lovely to be here again with you all here tonight. So welcome to the Long Room Hub at Trinity College Dublin, and I think a special thanks to our hosts here. So our colleagues in Trinity College, and also our colleagues in UCD. So we have the UCD School of Philosophy, the UCD School of Politics and International Relations, the UCD Centre for Human Rights, and Trinity College Dublin's Law School. And I suppose particularly also we have the other two colleges that are part of our lecture tour, which is NUIG, Galway, and Queen's University. So thank you very much for our host tonight and for all of you for coming and for being here. And before I introduce you to our wonderful lecturer tonight, I wanted to share a little bit of background around Frontline Defenders and also the annual lecture that we've been hosting here for a number of years. So we have been hosting the annual lecture since 2013. And the idea behind it is to provide a space for discussion and for debate, and a space for the range of the issues that are affecting human rights defenders to be discussed, to debate, and talked about. And when we speak to human rights defenders, and when we ask human rights defenders from all over the world, what is it that you need? What should we do? What they tell us again and again and again is we need to talk about this. We need to speak about this. We need people to know, and we need people to understand, and we need people to hear. And that idea of visibilizing, that word right, really speaking out, talking about what's happening, of discussing, of engaging. And you're all part of that by being here tonight. It's part of that process of hearing, of engaging, and of continuing to speak about and to recognize what's happening, because that's very much the first step in bringing about change, in addressing, in progression in that. So I think many of you are probably aware Frontline Defenders, but maybe for those who might be a little bit newer, we are a human rights organization. We're a global human rights organization that are based here in Ireland, but work globally around the world. And we work particularly with human rights defenders, but human rights defenders at risk. So a human rights defender is anybody who works to promote human rights. And there are many, many human rights defenders all around the world today, and many, I presume, in the room here as well. But we're particularly working with those human rights defenders who face risks because of the work that they do. So because of their human rights defender, their work, they're targeted. And they're targeted in many, many ways. And we have certainly seen that to such a dramatic degree within Afghanistan, and particularly with women human rights defenders there. So it's really apt today that we talk, that we shine a light, that we speak about particularly around women human rights defenders in Afghanistan, around not only the risks that they face, but the work that they're doing, and the really important work that they're doing in standing up and speaking out, and how we can protect and support them. With our work in Afghanistan, so since the Taliban takeover in August 2021, we've seen how Afghan women human rights defenders have continued to mobilize and to fight and to denounce the crisis for women human rights in Afghanistan. In Frontline, we've seen how they've paid a very heavy price and a gendered price for that work and what we do. And we've seen defamation, attacks, stigma, smear campaigns, sexual violence, a whole range of detention, criminalization against women human rights defenders in Afghanistan. Our work And I work together with Horia, very much with your guidance and your support, and many other very, very, very prominent, amazing human rights defenders from Afghanistan, is to try and support those women. And we support by digital protection to make sure that your phones, your laptop, the information that you have is safe and secure, the way that you communicate is safe and secure. But also protection grants. And these are small grants, quite small funds sometimes, anything from 3, 4, 5, 6 up to 7 or 8,000 euros, which when put into the hands of a woman human rights defender can be transformative. Because those small grants can be used to do things like medical support, legal fees, some really essential supports for temporary relocation, buying a new laptop or a new phone so you have digital protection and security. And our work is working together with those women human rights defenders to hear what exactly is it that you need that's going to make you more safe to continue to do the same rights work that you do. And I suppose to say in particular, we have been very fortunate over the last number of years to have some really, really influential, prominent, engaged human rights defenders from Afghanistan to support that work. And we wouldn't be able to do anything that we do because all of what we do is guided by women human rights defenders themselves. And one of those is, of course, Horia. And it's a huge thank you. It's such a privilege to be here, to have you here to speak with us, but also to be able to thank you in person for all of the collaboration and the support, because I know so much of the work that we have done wouldn't have been possible without you and your colleagues directing us, supporting us, enabling us, and showing us where we need to be and what we need to do. So it's very much, I think, a collaborative work that we've done together and that we're very grateful for now and for continued on in the future. Horia is a well-known and well-respected woman human rights defender. She's the founder of a number of organizations in Afghanistan, including the Safety and Risk Mitigation Organization that focuses on the protection of human rights defenders, and also the Conflict Analysis Network, which does research, advocacy, and capacity building. She's received numerous awards for her work, including the 2007 National Human Rights Award in Afghanistan, and the 2012 and 2015 Human Rights Defender Award from Amnesty International, and most recently the 2020 Award from Afghan Women's Network. And this has all been for her work on women, peace, justice, and reconciliation. So I'm really happy to welcome Horia here today, and for us to be able to hear, listen, and then following that, we'll have some space to have some conversations, some questions, and dialogue with Horia around the situation for women human rights defenders in Afghanistan. So please, to you.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Frontline Defenders for being a long-term friend of Afghanistan and particularly Afghan human rights defenders. And also, I would like to thank you all for making the time and coming tonight to listen to the situation in Afghanistan. To be honest, you know, like when people are asking me to speak about the human rights situation in Afghanistan, I don't know from where to begin, because like I'm a middle-aged woman. I spent much of my childhood and my adult life in war, conflict, and atrocities in Afghanistan. Like it will be nearly half a century since war started in Afghanistan by the Russian invasion back in 1979, and it continued since then. Like I have seen so much in Afghanistan over the I saw the button was red and I thought it's working. Thank you. So to be honest, you know, like when we speak of the human rights situation in Afghanistan, I don't know like which part should I ignore or which part I should focus more, because it is just like nearly half a century of atrocities that happens in that geography, which started with the Russia invasion and of course, but then how the West and particularly US-led support of the famous Mujahideen resistance back in 1980s, it fueled so much human rights violations around the country. And like as a child, I grew up seeing the communist regime killing and disappearing people simply for listening to the BBC radio. I grew up seeing my father had to use headphones and hide in the basement while he was trying to listen to the BBC radio during the communist era. And I have also seen that, you know, how teachers were killed by the Mujahideen supported by the US and Western countries. I have seen how schools were burned, how civil servants were killed when war against Russia was happening. So literally, many Afghans like us, we were stuck between two evils, I would say. Like none of them were doing any good. Not the communists, not the Mujahideen. And then slowly the situation evolved in 1992 when the Russia-backed regime collapsed and then the West supported Mujahideen resistance groups. They took control of Afghanistan, which subsequently it resulted in a civil war in the country. And just at the middle of the civil war by 1996, we had a group emerged in Afghanistan by the name of Taliban. Like, although the Taliban first shipped in Pakistan, in Quetta in 1994, but they were not much known till end of 95 and 1996 as the group started swapping all over Afghanistan. So one of the things that made this group very much different and identical from other militias or fighters or armed groups was that this group from the very beginning of their formation were against women and against culture and against art. It was their first, like I would say it is their brand to be against women, against art and against culture. Back in 1990s, of course, Taliban stopped girls from attending schools. Women were not allowed to work, and they were implementing harsh form of Sharia, which included like public executions, public amputations, public flogging, stoning to death, among many other public punishments they were doing to the people. And then the misfortunate events of 9/11 happened, and suddenly the US and UK, they decided to go and bomb Afghanistan to get rid of the Taliban because they were hosting Osama bin Laden. Simply the whole war on terror back in 2001 was justified, let's liberate Afghan women. And then the iconic footage of a woman being shot in the head by the Taliban in Kabul Stadium was making through the headlines around the world, and suddenly Afghanistan was on the international news headlines. And on that time, I still remember like many politicians, including George W. Bush, Laura Bush, or Sherry Blair, Donald Rumsfeld, and many others, they kept saying that, we are not going to compromise on the rights of Afghan women. Let's go and liberate Afghan women. And then with that, like they justified the military intervention in Afghanistan, which resulted in ousting the Taliban. And then for the 20 years between 2002 and 2021, many Afghans, including Afghan women, we took that opportunity to rebuild our lives. Millions of girls were going to school. Hundreds of thousands of women were working as civil servants, as politicians, as journalists, as teachers. Girls were going to universities, to schools, and we all were playing an active role in the public, social, political, and economic life of Afghanistan. It was also during these periods when, unfortunately, the insurgency started to take a toll on Afghanistan, and Taliban attacking and killing civilians, including suicide bombings, among many other crimes. So back in 2019, I still remember for the first time we heard that US and Taliban are negotiating peace and for a possible peace deal. That was also the time that I, among many other women human rights defenders, we went around and we kept saying that we are not against any peace deal. We are not against any peace negotiations with the Taliban, because at the end of the day, we know what is the cost of war. I lost my brother, I lost my cousins, I lost my home. I have been displaced so many times. My husband was injured, my brother was injured. So I have experienced that with my flesh and bone. So I'm not saying like the war should continue, but any peace negotiations, it has to be ethical. It has to have red line with the Taliban. You're putting red lines, and those red lines should be the Afghanistan constitution. It should be the rights of women and girls. And we know that Taliban, if they return to power, they are going back to the same rule they did in 1990s. Unfortunately, no one was listening. And many Western diplomats, they kept telling us that, oh, but Taliban have changed. We are only talking to the like-minded Taliban, or we are talking to reformed Taliban. So, and then we are saying, like, if they are reformed, then why they are the Taliban? If they are like-minded, then why they are the Taliban? So this doesn't make any sense. Make sure, like, whatever you are going to talk in the peace negotiations, make sure that you are protecting human rights and women's rights in those peace negotiations. But then it got to a stage that US started doing its own things, and Norwegians were in full gear in support of peace talks with the Taliban, among some other European countries. And then it got to a stage that I, with a group of other women, we were blacklisted by the embassies. We were blacklisted by the United Nations. We were blacklisted by many Western expatriates who were just calling us warmongers, war campaigners. They don't want peace in Afghanistan. And unfortunately, it got to a point that even no one wanted to meet with us, because we were talking about red lines. We were talking about protection of human rights and women's rights, and we were saying you cannot have peace without having all these preconditions in place. With everything happened, then in February 2020, US signed a deal with the Taliban in Doha, city of Qatar. And in that peace deal, no one really knows what was in that peace deal, because even many Western diplomats and UN was not involved and didn't know what was written in those secret annexes that is with the CIA. And what I heard, even the US Congress does not have access to those annexes. So then the peace deal was signed. There was no guarantee for human rights or women's rights or whatever. And then in return to our objection, the US envoy, Zalmay Khalilzad, who is also an Afghan origin, but he is a US citizen, he told us that, yes, we negotiated what was right for us. Now you should go and negotiate what you want the Taliban to do. And then in that peace, the moment they signed the peace deal with the Taliban, they also started to release over 10,000 Taliban prisoners. Many of them were convicted or suspected war criminals. Many of them were convicted of crimes against humanity. Many of them were convicted for war crimes and atrocities. But then again, everyone was set free. Unfortunately, on the August 2021, I was in London, and on that day I was supposed to go to Kabul, because on the 16th of August was my birthday and I wanted to celebrate that with my friends, family and everyone. The way that the whole situation was deteriorating, I wasn't sure how long it will take for Afghanistan to collapse, but I wanted to have those last moments with all my close ones to just remember. And just 5 o'clock in the morning, I received a phone call from a friend, and he said that, "Where are you?" I said, "Oh, I'm in London." He said, "Oh, you said you are going to Kabul." I said, "Yeah, I'm traveling. My flight is around 12 in the noon." So he said, "Okay, don't go, because Kabul fell to the Taliban." And I was like, "Really?" He said, "Yes, Taliban have entered the city." I called my husband in Kabul and I told him that, "Hey, listen, I heard that Taliban have entered the city." He said, "Oh, who is saying that? You know, I'm inside the bank and it's unusual crowd, but I didn't see any Taliban. Whoever told you, you know, it's just a rumor and something." And then I said, "Okay." And then I called back my friend and I said, "This is what my husband said." He said, "No, this is what happened. And I'm just telling you." Like, it literally took me 3 hours. I was calling my friends in the presidential office. I was calling my friends. And everyone was denying, and they were saying, "No, everything is normal. We don't see the Taliban. Who says that Taliban are there?" And just by 11 o'clock, Kabul time, which was almost like 9 o'clock UK time, I received a call from my husband and he said, "Yes, Surya, Kabul has failed and I don't know what should I do. I'm just stuck at the middle of the road and everyone is running. I don't know what should I do." And that moment, I suddenly felt like someone has poured a full bucket of hot water on me. I was paralyzed for a minute and I was shocked, I was numb. I didn't know how to react, whether to believe and not to believe. And to be honest, you know, like all sudden, all the 20 years of hard work that we have put in place, it just ran like a scenario in front of my eyes. And I saw how everything just collapsed with a blink of an eye in front of me. I just remembered how many sacrifices we made to get to this stage. I remembered how many lives we lost to get to that stage, to make sure that we have a constitution where men and women are entitled to equal rights, to make sure that women are having the right to political participation, to make sure that freedom of expression, freedom of association, freedom of assembly are protected in the constitution. And then suddenly, like, everything just fell in front of my eyes. And it took me a while to pull myself together. And the first thing I did, I was, you know, I contacted the Home Office in the UK and I told them about the situation, and they knew about it. They said, "Yes, can you please tell him to go to the airport, to this place, blah, blah, blah. Our forces are there so they can evacuate him." And then I was receiving calls and calls and calls from my friends. Someone was crying, someone was screaming, and everyone was running for their life everywhere. And it was like, when people are saying doomsday, I think that was the doomsday that I have seen what was happening to the scenes of the Kabul airport, where thousands and thousands of people rushed to the airport, and some even fell from the planes and they died, to the situation of, you know, people lost their family members, lost their children, and so many people were stepped on and they died in the crowd. And it was during those days that I was spending days and nights to make sure that we can evacuate as many women, as many men at risk as possible. To communicate with different people, to talk with different people, to, you know, to know like who is there, let's talk to them, who is there, let's talk to them, and make sure that these people are getting safely to the airport so they can leave. Leaving for America was easier, or getting to America was easier than getting to the airport in Kabul. It was just that one bloody mile that you could not make your way to the airport. That just 1 mile. And I had like a friend who was heavily pregnant, and she was a lawyer, and she was working on so many cases of, victims of the Taliban. And she was standing on her 2 feet for 18 hours inside that crowd in the airport. And she called me, she was crying. Sorry to say that, this is her word. And she said, "Horia, my bladder is exploding. If I leave the crowd, I made this far, I'm not sure if I can make it if I leave to go to the toilet. And if I stay, I can die." So with everything that happened, like in the past 2-3 years, like it will be 3 years this August, what we have seen, like, first of all, Taliban haven't changed. There are no like-minded Taliban, there are no reformed Taliban, there are no changed Taliban. What we are seeing is a gender apartheid regime that is ruling my country. What we are really seeing is a group that has taken control of the country and taken nearly 14 million of people as a hostage, and depriving more than half of the population from their fundamental and basic rights. Girls over the year 6 are not allowed to go to school. Universities are closed for the women and girls. Women are not even allowed to work in humanitarian aid agencies. Since August 2021 till now, over 120 edicts are issued by the Taliban, all against women. From closure of beauty parlors to forbidding women from going to parks, from stopping women to leave their homes without being accompanied by a man, to the dress code, to, like, you just name it. I think every night they sleep and the next day they come with another invention to more and more restrict, particularly the women of Afghanistan. But then the situation of the other members of the Afghan population is no better than what's happening on women. We are seeing a lot of war crimes are happening in the areas where armed resistance against Taliban are happening. We are seeing a lot of extrajudicial killings. Just in a matter of 1 week, I have documented 12 cases of assassinations and extrajudicial killings in Kabul alone against the former members of the security forces. This is just one city, and this is just the cases that made its way to the social or national media. And then you can look at the scale of it in all over Afghanistan. In this situation, again, women of Afghanistan, tens of women of Afghanistan, they are going on the streets. They are protesting, they are defying the rule of the Taliban. They are standing in the face of the Taliban. They are chanting and they are asking for the rights to education, for the rights to employment, and they have this slogan of education, work, and freedom. So this is the slogan they are giving. Many of these women protesters, they have been arrested, they have been killed, they have been tortured, they have been raped, they have been disappeared. Some lost family members, and some never returned to the family. Some were killed by their own family members as an act of honor killing. Despite all these challenges, still Afghan women are standing against the Taliban rule. Whenever they get an opportunity, they go on the streets, they fight, and they shout, and they ask for education, freedom, and employment. And at the same time, we also have tens of other men who are standing with these women. Like, there was a mass resignation of male university teachers who were resigning in the protest against the Taliban's banning girls from attending universities. Hundreds of male university students, they walked out of their classrooms, they walked out of their exams in support, in the solidarity with their female classmates when Taliban banned girls from attending university. We saw many journalists, they appeared on TV putting a face mask on their faces just to protest for what Taliban have been doing against them. But then not all of them goes unpunished by the Taliban. Like, at the moment we have so many human rights defenders, male human rights defenders and women protesters who are in Taliban prisons. They are kept for months without any due diligence. They are being kept for months without the due process. And they are kept arbitrarily. And at the same time, so many other women, they are also having underground schools, online schools, online universities, online education. And we are trying to do so many things to maneuver the Taliban's restrictions and to make sure that women are getting the education, women are getting the skills, women are getting it whenever it is possible and however it is possible. We have a lot of challenges, and at the same time, organizations like ours and with collaboration with the frontline defenders, we are still trying hard to protect as many human rights defenders as possible. We are trying to protect as many journalists as possible. We are trying to protect as many people at risk as possible. It is not easy. It puts my colleagues' life at risk. It puts the life of even people that you're serving, the family members of those activists at risk. But we have to do it, and someone have to do it. So I think we will not be able to do that without the support of organizations such as Frontline and like Freedom House and many others who are supporting us to provide those vital services. I would like to end my talk by giving a couple of recommendations. First of all, please don't stop talking about the situation in Afghanistan or other countries where atrocities and crises are happening. I, as an Afghan, I find it extremely, extremely disturbing and devastating that we, as victims, have to fight for attention. I don't want to dismiss the pain of an Ukrainian because I want the attention. I don't want to dismiss the pain of a Palestinian because I want the attention. I don't want to dismiss the pain of a Yemenis, a Sudanese, and Ethiopians because of what's happening in my country. But let's talk about all the atrocities that are happening around the world, which really, really need our attention, our solidarity. But please don't forget that Afghanistan today is remaining the only country in the world where women and girls are not allowed to enjoy their life, including their ban from school, their ban from employment, their ban to enjoy their fundamental and basic rights, access to health, access to education, access to employment. child marriage has increased significantly. Domestic abuse has increased significantly because Taliban also removed all the fundamental institutions that were once protecting women and girls against violence and against human rights violations. Let's talk about that. Write to your MPs, hold them to account. I know you have two great MPs in the European Parliament who always speak whether about Palestine or about Afghanistan and about other situations. But we want to see more of that happening. We don't want people to forget and think, you know, whatever is happening is okay or it's being justified under the name of religion or under the name of the culture. There is no culture, no religion to justify human rights violation and stopping people, especially women, from not having education, from not having it, right? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Maria, for this harrowing but also thought-provoking talk to us. I'm sure there will be lots of questions from the audience. We have about a bit more than half an hour to take questions, and I'm sure you'd be happy to answer some of them. So I'd invite as brief as possible and concise.
Hi, thank you so much for that presentation and for just giving a bit of context as well. I thought that was really helpful. My question is, so I work for a social media platform, and you mentioned about using online tools to promote education and other services. I'm just wondering, is there any other ways in which you're using social media platforms, for example, to... Oh, sorry.
Thank you. Should I start again? Or?
No,
that's okay. my question is, are you using social media platforms and other ways to try and defy the Taliban or promote the human rights or of Afghani women and give visibility to Afghani women and girls? And also, what are the ways in which the tech companies or social media platforms can help you? It's a bit, little bit like what was said earlier, like what can we do for you to help?
Thank you. Shall I answer one question?
Yes, or you receive? I think you can answer now if you want.
Okay, thank you. Yes, we are also using other digital tools, and social media is a significant part of that. For example, for the trainings that we do for the women human rights defenders on security and protection trainings, we often use different platforms. Like, for example, in some of the trainings that we give, like even for the WhatsApp, how they can use disappearing messages. It's as simple as that. Or how they can use other platforms such as Signal. And then social media is playing a big role. Social media is playing both negative and positive, because on the positive side, it also helps us a lot with our campaigning to bringing our plight to the attention of the world, to the attention of the media, sharing our stories, and also documenting the human rights violations. But from the other hand, like, you also see that there is a significant increase, like as you already mentioned, you know, like about all this online harassments and defamation attacks. So this also happens even more, particularly against women. If you see, like, if I post something, maybe four people will support, and then 10 other men, mostly, they come and they use abusive words, and they call names, they say things. So I think it is both an advantage and disadvantage. So I think in the past, especially 3 years, we all have developed some thicker skin to not to look at the negative part of it, but instead we should use the social media for particularly for increasing awareness raising, documentation of human rights violations and reporting of the incidents and things like that, but also sharing opportunities. Like, for example, if there is a scholarship that someone's aware, then you put that through the social media and then it circulates really, you know, among all people, and then from group to group, or from Facebook to Instagram to all the other social media platforms. So yeah, I think we are using those. But I think in terms of the support from the technology companies, unfortunately, I didn't see that. You know, I didn't see, like, there are so many giant tech companies, but I haven't seen much to support, especially the education for the Afghan workers.
Thank you. More questions?
Hello, good evening, and thank you for your very interesting comments. It seems to me that one of the issues is religion, and so I've got two questions. The first one, is there any evidence that the Taliban are, what would I say, progressing or developing or in any way becoming more modern? And the second question, is there any sense in which, if you like, the other faiths should try and dialogue? Is there a role for other faiths, Christian faiths, to, at a higher level, to maybe intervene? Europe has a long history, a few hundred, if not a few thousand years, of religious problems, so maybe we could bring some perspective. Just a thought.
Thank you. I think in terms of the, you know, if Taliban have reformed, yes, they have been becoming very good at lying. Now they are like professional liars, because before they would just lie to the Afghan public, now they are lying to the international community, and they are lying to their faces and without any accountability. They can promise one thing in the meeting, and the moment they walk away, like, what they call it, like, right on the ice and put it under the sand. So this is what they really do. Yes, they have been using technology to their favor. They are very good at propaganda war, and they have been using that propaganda significantly, especially the social media, and they have a number of YouTubers, they have a number of social media influencers who are just posting and doing things to show how things have improved, how things are good in Afghanistan under the Taliban. But if you think that they have been reformed in any way, no, unfortunately, we are not seeing any difference from a Taliban today, from a Taliban in 1990s. Except that now they are using smartphones and you know, traveling private jets to Oslo and Switzerland. Yeah, I think one more thing has also changed, that in 1990s, US was not paying them $50 million weekly basis. Now they are doing that every week. $40 million cash goes to the Taliban since August 2021. So God knows, like they say, it's for humanitarian purposes, but then why more than half of the population is starving? Why UN is always crying that, you know, around 90% of Afghans are starving? So we don't know where that money goes. Like in terms of the religion, I would say, like, there have been a lot of efforts by the Islamic conference organization, and even by Al-Azhar University, and a group of ulema, of Islamic scholars from different countries, including Turkey, Indonesia, and other places, they went and met with the Taliban. But unfortunately, it had very little impact. So it seems that they have their own version of Sharia, they have their own version of Islam. I hope that, you know, interfaith discussion at least can change that. But I don't know really. I think it's good to explore that option as well, but I don't know.
Okay. Gentleman at the back.
Thanks very much for your talk. As one journalist to another, I just want to say, express solidarity with you. You mentioned about writing to local parliamentarians to try and raise the issue of Afghanistan and the difficulties which women and girls experience. I'm wondering what type of engagement you believe the Irish government, or by extension the European Union, should have with Afghanistan. Is it to isolate and point out what they're doing wrong? Is it to engage? And if so, what type of leverage could there be? Is it financial aid? Is it trade? Or what type of bargaining could be used to assist you? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think in terms of the engagement, unfortunately, in the past, like 5-6 years, what we are seeing, like the whole engagement with the Taliban didn't bring any positive results to the Afghans. And most importantly, after August 2021, what we are really seeing is a lack of consistency among the members of the international community. Like, for example, when for the USA, what is really important is their national security and exchange of intelligence with the Taliban. And for the Europeans, it's important to stop refugees coming from Afghanistan. Or for another country, something else is important. If the issue of human rights and women's rights is not a concern for many countries who have the leverage to talk with the Taliban, I don't think the situation in the country will change. What is really important is that there have to be consistency. There have to be conditionality. And Taliban have to feel the pressure. They have not felt the pressure yet. If they are being invited to Oslo and Norwegian government is hiring a private jet to fly Taliban because they are in the international travel ban or sanction. So if Switzerland is inviting them to come to Geneva, or if you know some other European country, of course they are going to travel to Qatar, of course they are going to travel to Turkey or to Russia or to China. But what about the countries who are claiming that they are defenders of human rights? What about the countries that are claiming that they are abiding with the international law and they are respecting the international human rights standards? So I think what is really important is, first, there have to be consistency. Second, you know, any engagement have to be conditional with the Taliban. Like, there have to be a certain benchmarks, like, if you're not allowing girls to go to school, we are going to isolate you. We are not going to engage with you at all. Even we are not going to sit with you in the same room. But unfortunately, that has never happened. And even, you know, I hear that from the members of the Taliban who are saying that the moment civil society goes away, the same Western diplomats are coming and patting at our back and saying, we understand all the issues of religion and culture, so we totally understand that, don't worry, you know. Like, if they are speaking with that language, do you think the Taliban will change anything on the ground for us? No, unfortunately. So, I think it is really important to have the consistency and to have conditionality.
Thank you very much indeed for your talk. Colin Rafter is my name. I used to work in the Irish Department of Foreign Affairs. I have two questions for you. Relations with neighbouring countries, particularly Pakistan and Iran, are they helping or are they part of the problem? And secondly, and it's not your area of expertise, I know, but I'd just be interested, do you have any views on the cultivation of poppy seeds? Has it increased or decreased under the Taliban? Thank you very much indeed.
Yeah, thank you. I think in terms of the Iran and Pakistan, they never played a positive role in Afghanistan. Unfortunately, like sometimes I wonder if we had only an opportunity to move, but we can't. We are stuck with the same neighbors for the rest of our life. I think in terms of the poppy cultivation have went down significantly. But this is simply not because Taliban want to eradicate poppy in Afghanistan, because they are putting a lot of efforts in production of crystal meth, which is now Afghanistan is producing quite a high amount of crystal meth instead of poppy, first thing. Second, do you want to also control the international market for the opium? Do you want to control the prices? They did that back in 1990s, and you can see like the moment they put an poppy eradication policy, the international price for the drugs are going up, and this is their politics. So from one hand, they can really make people happy that, oh, we are eradicating the poppy, but from the other hand, it is because they want to control the international market, and also they are putting a lot of effort in production of crystal meth, which is much, much dangerous than the poppy itself.
Thank you.
Yeah, at the back.
Hiya, thank you very much for your talk this evening. I've got two questions. After 20 years of democracy, why do you think it fell away so quickly? The Taliban were able to sweep straight back in as if nothing had ever happened. And then secondly, what way do you see the future unfolding? What is the path towards removing the Taliban or getting Afghanistan back to where it needs to be?
Yeah, I think, to be honest, you know, the past 20 years of democracy, I think, you know, I think most of times I ask the same question myself, like what happened, why we went back to the same stage. I think there are several issues, like it's a combination of different issues. Like I think one of the biggest issues was like the people who were installed as leaders in our country, mostly by the US, you know, even like 2014 elections, we all know it was a fraudulent election, and how US and UK pushed for Ashraf Ghani to become the president and not allowing the other candidate which won the election to become the president. Like, you know, this is one of the examples. And second, I think it is privatization of the war. Because what happened, like, Pentagon is not sending their troops to fight in Afghanistan as much as they send the contractors. A contractor who was having like a contract of $50 million in 2002, at the end of the war, his contract was over $1 billion. Is it difficult for them to also fuel insurgency in order to get bigger contracts? I think privatization of the war itself has played a devastating role in Afghanistan, in fueling insurgency, in fueling human rights violations across the country. And the other reason that it failed is also because I think still the Afghanistan security forces were not prepared enough to take the control. They needed the time to take the control, and that time was not given to them. And at the time when the collapse happened, like even it came as a surprise to the security forces, it came as a surprise to so many people. Like few people on the top, they knew what they are doing. This is why like they started asking not to resist, not to fight, and hand over. Not to resist, not to fight, hand over, because US is leaving, and we are on our own, and we don't want to fight. So I think there were several issues, and few of them that I have mentioned to you. It wasn't because Taliban were very powerful. It was because we were dealing with a very weak system, a dependent system. So that unfortunately played a role in the whole thing. And above all, like dishonesty among our international friends. Like I still feel a deep, deep sense of betrayal by the people who once said that you're not compromising on the rights of women and girls, how they handed me over back to the Taliban, even without looking at their back. So I think, there is, and also I think there is a lot on our own side as Afghans to take many of those blames as well, especially our politicians, especially people who are at the, I would say like at the decision-making level in Afghanistan. Like the public didn't know what they are doing and what business they are into. And they, till the last minute, when the president fled, even the Minister of Foreign Affairs didn't know. The first vice president didn't know. So unfortunately, like, yeah.
The future,
to be honest, you know, like, what I really, really strongly believe is that, you know, like, there shouldn't be any other war. I don't think that the war is the solution. I think that change needs to come from within Afghanistan and from the among Afghan people. Like, all that needs to be done is how we can support all those democratic forces, all those people who truly believe for social justice, for human rights, for fundamental human rights values to stand and continue with their fight. Like, I genuinely think that anything from outside will not work, because if foreign countries come with their bombs, with their tanks, they will leave again, and we will be back on our own, and we don't want that. We don't want to repeat the same mistake. We have learned from our lessons. Like, if they are going to play any role, that should be that they should support people who are fighting from inside, who want to bring the change. Whether that change will be to toppling the Taliban, or whether that change will be a political change, whether that change will be a transition, I don't know what that change will be. But we really need to support people and groups who are working to bring that change.
The mic is coming.
Thank you. And on supporting that change, I'm wondering, we saw how all of the spaces for women and women human rights defenders closed. First the workplace, then the colleges and universities, the salons. What spaces are left? So where are women, particularly women, coming together? How are they communicating? Where are they convening? Where does the resistance sit in many ways? And that idea of what's nascent, because I know what we see in so many places is even when all of those things are taken away, women are phenomenally creative. And they're very, very good at creating those spaces and that. And what does it look like?
Yeah, thank you. I think, yes, you're right, because we are quite creative in how to maneuver things. And those spaces are, for example, you see, like, two girls, they are wearing burqa and they are singing songs. They are singing beautiful love songs and they play that on social media. No one knows who they are, but they are defying the Taliban rule banning women from singing. Like, you have a woman, she's wearing a burqa and she's riding bicycle around her home or somewhere isolated, and she posted that on social media. Or a group of girls covering their faces and they're playing football somewhere and they're posting that on social media. Like, they're just trying to create that space, you know, or they have closed doors protests, you know, they're burning Mullah Hebatullah's photo. They're, like, you know, giving slogans, they're talking about it, but they're in a closed door place. And they're really using social media for that. They're using TikTok, Facebook, and all the other platforms in order to defy that. But at the same time, like, you know, we are also collaborating a lot amongst ourselves. Like, if someone needs, for example, someone is under, like, being, what you call it, like, she's in risk of being arrested. Like, then slowly, you know, like, someone, yeah, you know, this woman was arrested, and I think the whole group will be arrested with her. Let's go underground. And then, you know, like, they exhaust all the resources that they have, and then they make sure that, you know, they can go hiding. They are not being seen. They are just disappearing, you know, for a while, and, you know, alerting the family and all that. So, for example, one of the women, she said that she was a woman protester, that Taliban knew when she was on the protest, they came after her home. And then the family denied that she's not living here, we don't know who is she, and blah, blah, blah. So then what they did, like, the family, they put, like, a signal for her. like whenever when they see, like, for example, the Taliban are around, or you know, if the situation was very hectic, they would just put a little red piece of cloth just near the street. There was this electricity pole, so someone would go and tie that up. So when the woman was saying, like, the moment I pass and I see the red thing, I just go. I don't enter the street. Like, you know, you always have to find ways to do things without, like, I wouldn't say that it's secure 100%, but at the same time, like, you're trying to take your chances and do as much as you can to protect yourself. Like, sometimes you're lucky and sometimes you're unlucky.